Hello everyone, I welcome you to my YouTube channel. Here I discuss all about civil engineering and also you'll be getting my video lectures regarding various topics over here. So now in this video I'll be discussing about geometric design of highways. So after we are done with the history and the planning of highways, now we need to know the geometric design, and there are various factors which are responsible for the geometric design of highways. And this chapter is basically concerned with the physical dimensions and layout of visible features of highways. And with proper geometric design, these roads can serve the purpose in the best possible manner. So you are now getting how important this chapter it is. So first of all, there are some considerations which govern the fixation of various standards for geometrical design, and there comes the first thing, that is the adequate right of way. There shall be sufficient right of way. Right of way actually means the area acquired by the road authority for highway development projects, etc. So there must be sufficient land available so that the government can develop various projects regarding the highways. So there must be an adequate right of way. Secondly, there shall be adequate side distance. So the road should be designed in such a way that the driver should be able to see sufficient distance. And next, adequate formation of width, the foundation width, the subgrade width should be the adequate enough. And next, provision of super elevation or sharp horizontal curves. So guys, you might be thinking about these terms, and don't worry about this, we'll be learning about it in the very next sections of in this particular chapter only. But till then, you just try to remember these things. Like, we need adequate right of way, adequate side distance, adequate width formation, provision of super elevation on sharp horizontal curves. Next is provision of suitable horizontal and vertical curves to avoid discomfort, reasonable gradients, sufficient camber or cross slope. And next, suitable design speed, width of carriageway. So there are various factors which govern the fixation of various standards of geometrical design. Next, we come to the structure of road. This is basically the diagram of the cross section of the road, and you can see the GL is the ground level. GL is the ground level over which we make this subgrade, and above it a base course is applied, and finally we get the surfacing over which the vehicles travel. So basically there are four parts in the cross section of the road structure: the subsoil, subgrade, base, and the surfacing. So first of them is the subsoil. Subsoil, the natural or the prepared soil on which the road has to be formed and should be stable. So first of all, the soil on which we prepare the road and has to be formed and should be stable. So before making a road, there should be a stable soil ensured by the road authority or the construction company before making some roads. Next is the subgrade. Subgrade is its main purpose is to support the road and its foundation. It basically serves as the foundation of the road cross section and may be same or above or below the ground level. So डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द पर्पस, द सबग्रेड कैन बी ऑन द ग्राउंड लेवल, कैन बी लोअर देन द ग्राउंड लेवल एंड कैन एट बी द हायर, कैन एट बी सम हायर एलिवेशन देन द ग्राउंड लेवल. तो सपोज यू हैव फील्ड्स, फील्ड्स, पैडी फील्ड्स एट्सेट्रा बिसाइड द रोड्स वेयर वाटर हैज़ टू बी क्लॉग्ड फॉर वेरियस एग्रीकल्चरल पर्पसेस. सो देयर द सबग्रेड ऑफ द रोड शुड बी हायर देन द ग्राउंड लेवल. एंड ऑन द अदर हैंड देर आर टू रोड्स पासिंग साइमल्टेनियसली वेयर एज वन हैज़ टू क्लाइंब ओवर अ माउंटेन एंड द अदर वन हैज़ टू गो डाउन टू अ सबवे, देन द रोड गोइंग डाउन टू द सबवे विल हैव इट्स सबग्रेड लेयर लोअर देन द ग्राउंड लेवल. सो नेक्स्ट कम्स इज द बेस कोर्स. इट शुड बी स्टेबल एंड मस्ट बी कैपेबल टू रेजिस्ट इट्स डिस्टॉर्शन अंडर ट्रैफिक लोड्स टू अ ग्रेट एक्सटेंट. शुड बी ऑफ सफिशेंट थिकनेस सो हैज टू डेवलप गुड बॉन्ड विद द सर्फेसिंग. नेक्स्ट इज द सर्फेसिंग. द टॉप मोस्ट कोर्स ऑल्सो नोन एज द वेयरिंग कोर्स प्रोवाइड्स अ स्मूथ एंड स्टेबल रनिंग सर्फेस. इट शुड बी इम्परवियस, ड्यूरेबल, नॉन स्लिपरी एंड डस्टलेस. सो द टॉप सर्फेस शुड बी स्मूथ, सो नो काइंड ऑफ डर्ट और इम्प्योरिटीज और एनी टाइप ऑफ स्लिपरीनेस shall be encouraged. It is solely meant for the smooth travel of any kind of vehicle. Okay, so this was all about your structure of the road. Next comes the width of the pavement. So after we define the structure of the road, we need to know the width of the pavement. So how much wide a pavement must be depending upon the number of traffics that are traveling through it. So it is decided by number of traffic lanes. Of course, a place which will be having a lot of traffic, which will be having lot of vehicles in its peak hour, suppose, so it has to have some more number of traffic lanes. But if a place is not having that much traffic, then the traffic lanes should be somewhat lesser, like one lane or two lane would be sufficient. So the width of pavement is totally decided by the number of traffic lanes. And the traffic lane is the longitudinal strip of carriageway wide enough to accommodate forward movement of vehicle in a single line. So guys, this is very important point, as it is the definition of the word traffic lane. So traffic lane is the longitudinal strip of carriageway wide enough to accommodate forward movement of vehicle safely in a single line. So this is the you have seen any road where you will find stripes in between and the road is divided in two parts. So where one vehicles are going in one direction and the other vehicles are going in just the opposite direction. So these are known as the lanes. It can be from 2 to 4 to 6 depending upon the number of traffic passing through that road. Next is the width of the lane. It is decided on the basis of width of the vehicle and the minimum side clearance. Again, it will also this width of the lane will depend upon the type of vehicles traveling through it. Suppose very large trucks or lorries or buses will be going, so we need to have a wider cross section of road and a wider lane. But if it is a very small colonized area where only small traffic is seen, so we need not to have a very wider lanes. Next, IRC has recommended 2.44 meter as the maximum width of vehicle and 0.68 meter as the side margins, and hence 2.44 plus 0.68, approximately 3.8 meter shall be the width of a lane. So, and if we have two or more lanes, then it should be 3.5 meter width per lane. So here IRC has given its standards considering 2.44 meter to be the maximum width of a vehicle and 0.68 meter as the side margins. So whenever we sum it up, it is somewhere around 3.8 meter, and hence IRC has suggested width of a lane should be 3.8 meter, and that is for single lane. Whenever there are two or more lanes, the width shall be 3.5 meter per lane. So each lane shall be 3.5 meter. So here is a diagram. You can pause the video and you can notice the diagram carefully. See, here it is. 2.44 meter is taken as the width of the carriageway and 0.68 meter is the clearance. So as a whole we get 3.8 meter for single lane, and at the same time it is said that it should be 3.5 meter. It should be 3.5 meter for two or more lanes. So in the very next diagram, two lanes are taken, each of 3.5 meter width, and hence we will get a 7 meter wide road. So 2.44 meter is considered the maximum possible width of a carriage vehicle, and if two vehicles are there and the remaining area is somewhat divided like this, see 0.53, 1.06 and 0.53 as the side clearance. So whenever we have more than one lanes in a road, the side clearance get reduced and accordingly we adjust the lane width. So here's a table given, like width of pavement or carriageway for single lane. The width of the pavement shall be 3.75 meter for all roads and may be decreased to 3 meter for village roads. And two lanes without raised curves, it's 7 meter. Two lanes with raised curves shall be 7.5 meter. About curves, we'll be reading it very soon. Just keep on. For that, for the next very while, you can know that curve is one kind of boundary between the pavement and the sidewalks. And next is intermediate carriageway, except on important roads, should be 5.5 meter, and multi-lane pavement shall be 3.5 meter per lane. In order to express highway capacity, passenger car unit is used. So PCU, that is the passenger car unit, is basically an unit used by the highway designers to give it to a certain vehicle. Suppose a bicycle or motorcycle is considered 0.5 units of a vehicle, and whereas a passenger car or tempo or auto rickshaw and all these all the vehicles of comparable sizes as a passenger car are given one unit of this passenger car unit. Okay, so now you are getting the idea what is a passenger car unit. Bicycle, it is given 0.5. Cycle rickshaw, it is given 1.5, as it is considered that it will, though cycle rickshaw isn't as big as the passenger cars, but it is considered that it is a slower vehicle, so it will be considered, it will be given 1.5 units for highway design. Next is the truck bus. They are much larger, so they are given 3. Horse drawn vehicle 4, and small bullock cart 6, and large bullock cart 8. Next is the traffic separators or the medians, which are basically known as the dividers. See here, suppose there are two lanes of the road and in between we have a separator, traffic separator or median, or in normal words we call it medians. And here you will see various plantations are there, and these are solely meant to avoid collisions and the vehicles are smoothly traveling in their particular lane. So these are meant for avoiding collision, head-on collisions. They also channelize the traffic in two different lanes. They protect the pedestrians. Suppose if you are traveling on the footpath and you are sure that the vehicle shall be going in one particular direction. But suppose this divider was not there, or the traffic separator was not there, then you wouldn't have been sure a vehicle will be going in which direction, this or this. Next is to segregate slow traffic. It also segregates slow traffic. Many a cases you will be seeing that slower vehicles are being diverted to some other lane. In various highways you will be seeing this. So these are again meant to segregate slow traffic, and as per IRC it should be 3 to 5 meter wide. IRC has suggested it to be 3 to 5 meter wide. Next is the curbs. So you have been hearing the term curbs for a few while, so let us read them now. That curbs are the boundary between the road pavement and footpath. So suppose this is the road pavement and this is the footpath. This thing is known as the curb. This is the boundary between the road pavement and the footpath. So curbs are again divided into three classes: the class 1 curbs, the class 2 curbs and the class 3 curbs. So class 1 curbs are lower mountable curbs, 70 to 80 mm, and it helps vehicle climb the curb easily. Class 2 curbs are urban parking or low speed barriers, 150 to 200 mm, and if they are enough for a vehicle driver to possibly run over this curb in case of emergency. So in case of emergency, a vehicle driver can run over the curb and go to the footpath. So 150 to 200 mm is the suggested height for these curbs. Class 3 curbs are 230 to 450 mm. They are high speed barriers, and in no case the vehicle leaving the roadway at any circumstances should be able to climb up them. So they cause obstruction to vehicles leaving the roadway at any circumstances. Next is the right of way. Right of way, it is used to indicate the area of land required acquired along the road alignment by the highway organization. So it indicates the area of land acquired by the road alignment by the highway organization. So suppose we need a two lane road of 7 meter width. Still then the highway authority will be taking 10 meter or 15 meter wide area for their own purpose, and it is solely meant for some other things like the drainage, the side distances and the embankment. So there are various factors which depend for this right of way, and again this right of way also gives the chance for roads expansion. Suppose the traffics are increasing, two lanes are not sufficient and we need to go to three lanes. So for making this other lane we need not to worry about the area. So we will have this wider right of way, and it will provide us the extra area for making a separate lane. So land width is governed by width of formation, depends upon the highway type, road width and road margins, and secondly height of embankment of cutting depth, thirdly the side distance, and fourth the drainage system or topography. Our next topic is the camber. The camber is the slope of line joining the crown and the edge of the road surface. So suppose this is a road pavement, a road actually appears like this. This part is known as the crown and this is the edge. So this entire thing, this entire thing will be your camber. This entire thing will be your camber, and it is also referred to as the crossfall or cross slope or transverse slope. So basically you just remember one thing: the side slope available for a road for drainage purposes are known as the cambers. And these are designated by expression 1 in n, 1 vertical is to n horizontal. For example, for a cross slope 1 in 50, for a cross slope 1 in 50 in a road of width 40 meter, the camber will be given by 40 by 2 into 1 by 50 is equal to 0.4 meter. So 1 by 50 is the slope and 40 is the width of the road, and 2, it is divided by 2 for taking one particular half of the road, because a cross slope exists in one half of the road, not the whole length of the road. So here are three various types of camber. First is the parabolic camber, and it is given by the equation y is equal to 2x square upon nw. It is quite a parabolic equation. You can see 1 in n is the relative slope, and next you have the straight line camber. W by 2n is the height, 1 in n is again the slope, and finally we have the combination of straight and parabolic camber, and it is oftenly used in most of the road cross sections. Part of the camber will be straight, again this part will be parabolic, again for the same will be repeated in the other section, half parabolic and half straight. So it is a combination of straight and parabolic. Next, here are some IRC values for camber. You can just check over it. Concrete or bituminous has 2% and 1.7% for heavy rain and light rain respectively. Gravel or WBM 3% and 2.5% respectively, and earthen 4% and 3%. Design speed. The maximum speed at which the vehicles can travel continuously and safely under favorable conditions is known as the design speed. So this is the maximum speed a vehicle can travel continuously without any collisions or any type of unpalatable disasters. It will travel safely and maintaining all the favorable conditions. This is known as the design speed. It depends on the class of the road. Of course, an NH or SH will be having higher speed as compared to an MDR, ODR or VR. And secondly, the class of terrain, plain or rolling or mountainous or steep. So plain or rolling, there is a difference. So plain or rolling will have somewhat lesser speed as compared to the mountainous or steeper ones, because in mountains we tend to have a higher velocity because of the slope. If it is a down slope, we will have a higher velocity, and if it is an up slope, we will be having a lesser velocity. Next is the terrain classification. For plain, the cross slopes will be 0 to 10. For rolling, 10 to 25, mountainous 25 to 60, and for steep, it is 60. And again, here's design speed as per IRC. And just keep it remembered, this is kilometer per hour. As per IRC, ruling and minimum, and NS and SH, it is, you can just go through this table. Next, the important and topic of this chapter is the stopping side distance. It is the minimum distance over which the driver traveling at design speed can apply brakes and bring the vehicle to stop position safely without colliding with any other obstruction. Suppose a driver and okay. Let's make the diagram over here. Suppose a driver was traveling in this direction and he saw one obstruction over here. So what he needs to do, he has to put some brake, and there must be a sufficient distance till this obstruction so that he avoids collision with this. He reaches somewhere very near to it, but by avoiding collision. So stopping sight distance is the minimum distance over which the driver traveling at a design speed, the driver shall also be traveling at design speed. Okay, traveling at design speed can apply brakes and bring the vehicle to stop position safely without colliding with any other obstruction. Okay, the factors which will affect SSD are efficiency of brakes, frictional resistance between road and tires, slope of road surface, speed of vehicle, total reaction time of the driver. So for this we have a theory known as the PIEV theory. So P stands for perception, I stands for intellection, E stands for emotion, and V stands for volition. So perception time is the time required for the sensations received by the eyes. So whenever a driver is seeing an obstruction, he needs to sense that there is a certain obstruction and yeah, I need to stop my vehicle. So this time taken for the driver to understand is known as the perception time. Next is the intellection. This is the time required to understand the problem. Suppose there is a very big cart standing in front of you. So the driver has to analyze what type of danger that can be possible to him if he gets collided to it, and it is totally dependent upon the ability of driver. So the driver must understand the problem and at the same time should react to it. Again, next point is the emotion time. Time for emotional sensations like fear, anger. So it does happen to many persons, like whenever you are traveling and you see an obstruction, you get angry, and even if the obstruction is very tougher, you feel some fear that something might happen. So there is an emotion time, and sometimes we do react late to it. So emotion time shall also be considered. And next is the volition time, which is the time taken for the final action. So there are total 4 stages where the PIEV theory acts, and it is very important for considering, very important consideration for design of the stopping sight distance for a particular vehicle. So here we come to the derivation, that is the length of SSD shall be the braking distance plus the lag distance. So how does the braking distance do come? It is the distance traveled after brakes are applied. So it's not like that whenever the brakes are applied the vehicle will be stopping at that position. It will be certainly skidding to a certain length. So the work done against the friction is F into L. Suppose L is the length it will be skidded, and F is the coefficient of, is a maximum frictional force. So F is the maximum frictional force and L is the length it will be traveling after the brakes are applied. It will be skidding, I should say. So the work done against the friction is F into L, and F is the maximum frictional force, which actually equals to F into W. F is the coefficient of friction and W is the weight of the vehicle. So here you can see, you can relate it to work energy and force principles, like the work is the force into displacement, and the force, frictional force, is the coefficient of friction into the mass of the vehicle or the weight of the vehicle which we are used for traveling. So therefore the total work done will be, just replace F into W in this capital F, so you'll get F into W into L. Again, kinetic energy stored in the vehicle, that is half mv square, and replacing m by w by g, we get half mv square equal to half wv square by g. Now this kinetic energy shall be equal to the work done against the friction. So we need to equate these two equations, equation 2 and 3, and thus we get this thing, and on simplifying this we will get this thing, that is L equal to V square by 2GF, and this is the braking distance. Next is the lag distance. Lag is due to the PIEV theory, that is the initial lag which we will be considering, and the length of SSD will be thus D plus L, that is the lag distance. D is the lag distance and L is the braking distance. Lag distance will be given by D is equal to V into T, and hence the total length of SSD will be VT plus V square by 2GF. Now let us consider that the road will be sloping. So it is not likely that the road will be straight, it can be sloping. So considering the sloping condition, see, here are two different sloping condition. In the first one, the vehicle is ascending in a slope, and in the second one, the vehicle is descending in a slope. You can see this V. This one's ascending and this one's descending. So W will be the weight of the vehicle, and we can divide this into two components, that is the W sin theta and the W cos theta, if theta is the angle of the slope. So upon dividing this, we will get some equations like F into FW plus minus W sin theta into L is equal to W V square by 2G. So this kinetic energy equation which we got over here, this one can be replaced by this considering the slopes, and for very small gradient theta is equal to, is very close to sin theta and is also very close to tan theta, and that shall be n by 100. So equating that in equation 6, we get, so just replace sin phi with n by 100, so we get FW plus minus WN by 100 into L is equal to WV square upon 2G, and thus on simplifying this we will get this one. And now putting equation 7 in equation 5, this is the equation 5, and we put this equation 7, this L equal to V square by 2GF plus minus 0.01N, and hence the final equation for SSD will stand out to be this VT plus V square upon 2G into FB plus minus 0.01N. So there must be a question in your mind, what is B? B is the braking efficiency, because in the whole design of this process, the getting the formula in this whole process, we never ever considered the braking efficiency, and it is here at the last where we will be considering the braking efficiency, and we will be using as a multiplicative factor with the friction coefficient. So this was all about the stopping sight distance. So guys, the numericals related to it is on a separate video whose link is given in the description. Also, this very next topic, overtaking sight distance OSD, it will also be having some numericals, and the numerical video lecture is given in the same video whose link is given in the description. So overtaking sight distance is the minimum distance visible to a driver of a vehicle who is intending to overtake the slow moving vehicle ahead safely against the traffic of opposite direction. So what are the cases? There must be a fast moving vehicle like this, and there should be a slow moving vehicle like this. A is a fast moving vehicle and B is a slow moving vehicle. And A has to safely overtake B without getting collided to another vehicle C, who is traveling in the opposite direction. Okay, so the factors affecting OSD are speed of the overtaken and the vehicle coming from opposite direction. So it will be very much dependent on the speed of the three vehicles considered in this case. Secondly, the space between the overtaking and the overtaken vehicle. So there must be some space between the overtaking and the overtaken vehicle, that must be considered. Skill and the reaction time of driver, very important thing, the time he will take to react. Next is the rate of acceleration of overtaking vehicle, and finally the gradient of the road. So here if you check the diagram, there are few considerations, like D1 is the initial distance taken that a vehicle A, when it is traveling, for overtaking B, it first has to come to the A2 position, and this distance shall be D1. Next, S will be the minimum spacing between A and B. Then after only S amount of distance is available with B, this vehicle A will start its overtaking process and finally reach to the position A3, whereas in that time vehicle B will reach to the position B2, and this A3 position must be achieved before C1 comes to the position C2. So this is taken as D3, the C1 to C2, and again this minimum spacing S is there, and this is the B, which is the distance traveled in the overtaking process. So this is the total overtaking side distance if we consider all these three distances, that is D1, D2 and D3. So D1 is the distance traveled by A in the reaction time VB into T, where VB is the speed of the moving vehicle in meter per second. Spacing between vehicle A and B just before the starting of overtaking operation, that is between A2 and B1, is equal to S meters. So the minimum spacing, that shall be S meter, which I have shown in the diagram. Next is S is equal to 0.7 VB plus length of the vehicle. How to get S? It is 0.7 VB plus length of the vehicle if the velocity is in meter per second, and secondly, if the velocity is in kilometer per hour, it will be considered as 0.2 capital VB plus length of the vehicle. This is how we will get S. Next, distance traveled by vehicle B in T second will be given by B is equal to VB into capital T, and D2 is B plus 2S meters. D2 will be given by B plus 2S meters. Just as you can see the diagram, D2 is B plus S, that is B plus 2S. Next, D2 is again VBT plus half AT square using equation of motion. After we use it, that is somewhat like, you know, S is equal to UT plus half AT square. It is quite the derivative of that. D2 is equal to VBT plus half AT square, and then by equating 1 and 2 we will get B plus 2S is equal to VBT plus half AT square, and upon simplifying we will get 2S is equal to half AT square, and therefore capital T will be is equal to square root of 4S upon A, and it is simplified as 14.4 S upon A, we need to remember this one, that is 14.4s upon a. It will be used for the problems. Again, during the operation taken by A, let C as the velocity v meter per second. C is the third vehicle which is coming from opposite direction. It has v meter per second velocity, and therefore D3 will be the distance traveled by it, that is v into t meters. And hence finally OSD will be the sum of D1, D2 and D3. Intermediate side distance. This is to provide opportunity for overtaking operations on horizontal curves or in restricted areas. It is provided by ISD is equal to 2 into SSD. It is basically twice of stopping side distance. Next is grade compensation on horizontal curves. In order to avoid resistance beyond a definite limit, gradients on curves are reduced, and such reduction is known as grade compensation on curves. So to avoid resistances beyond a definite limit, so there are gradients on curves are reduced, and thus the reduction is known as the grade compensation. So sometimes for this purpose we need to reduce the grades, and this grade compensation is given by 30 plus r by r, where r is the radius of curvature in meters. So that's, we will stop this video over here. The next part will be discussed in the part 2 of the geometric design of highways. And for problems, you can get the link in the description. There is a separate video lecture for the problems on these three particular topics. Thank you.